Because you have to realize that you're even playing a game, and so most people don't realize this.
Yeah.
They are lots of people. And the type of people that are attracted to that are sort of the tyrants. And the reason why Bitcoin is that cheat code is, number one, it helps us beat inflation. Right? So it gets us out, it gives us an asset that's outside of the game. We don't need permission from anybody to do anything. Learn how to make more money by providing more value. And then, now that you're making more income, turn that into Bitcoin.
There's a game going on, and the game is really like the infinite money glitch. We have to be able to look after ourselves going into the future. The money is broken. It's controlled in many levels. And one thing that I hear quite a lot is people talk about they. There's this group of people, they, them, that control the world, and they're making it very hard for people to be able to get ahead. And these people, whoever they are, trying to keep people under control, keep them modern-day fiat slaves. Number one, who is they? And number two, how do we break out of this system that is designed to keep us trapped by design?
Yeah, good question. I think they are different people depending on what you're talking about. So overall, I think about they I think about it like a flock of birds. So you see like a flock of birds and they're like flying in formation, for example, right? And those birds, obviously they don't talk. They didn't sit on the ground and say, hey, like you fly over there, you fly there, right? They just flock together, birds of a feather flock together, right? And they sort of bob and weave and move together. So they are lots of people, but they went to a lot of the same schools. So they've learned a lot of the same things. And they have gotten to positions of power. They're being influenced by other people. So, and I don't believe they, all of these people, are following like one single playbook or under one person's control, like a puppet master sort of thing. But they're like those birds that just sort of all sort of move together. So I think, you know, you kind of have politics and sort of control, whether it be over institutions or political institutions or bank institutions. And the type of people that are attracted to that are sort of the tyrants, sort of like the people that want that power.
Yeah.
And so it attracts those type of people, and then they just kind of move together. That's how I look at it.
Yeah. So how do we break that system? If that's the current system, we've got this fiat system that is not really great for the masses.
Yeah.
How can the everyday person opt out of something that's so destructive?
So the first thing I think is you have to realize that you're even playing a game. So most people don't realize this.
Yeah.
The next level of awareness is people realize that there's like a game going on, but it's rigged against them. And so that's like the next level. And then the third level is realizing it is a rigged game, but then I can just play by their rules, right? And so the very fact that we know some people have broken out of that game and got success, we just see what they're doing. And so how do we do that? So we think about, well, how is it rigged against us? So number one, we're put into debt slavery from the beginning, right? So we're encouraged to go to school, get debt, buy houses, get debt, et cetera. Number two, taxes. So taxes eat into a massive amount of our wealth creation. It prevents wealth from being transferred down from generation to generation. Three, we have inflation. So inflation is stealing our purchasing power. I would say number four, through our education system. So not only does our education system not teach us the things that we need to know, more importantly, what the education system does, and I think is way more dangerous, the education system was designed in Prussia in the 1800s, and it was designed to create factory workers that were compliant. And what does that mean? It means that it would create people who learn how to follow orders. So they didn't want people acting out or acting on their own or thinking outside the box. And that was not so bad in the industrial world, where we're in an analytical world, but today we're in a creative world. And what the school system does, it not teaching you things is bad enough, but it removes the creativity. And I believe that is the single most important skill that we need to get ahead today.
Yeah.
Because all wealth comes through creativity. Now, again, in the industrial age, it was like, I'm on an assembly line. I put my widget on, you put your widget on. But the reason why we have this divide between rich and poor today is because people are becoming more creative and they're using new tools like AI and internet, etc. And so school not only doesn't teach you that, it also takes away your creativity. So that's a problem. So we got debt, we got inflation, we have education, we have health, right? So the system for health is again rigged against us. And so we're stuck in this game and we're not able to get ahead and we're not able to really see how to get ahead. And so, you know, we're here at Cheat Code Conference and I just talked about how Bitcoin is that cheat code. And the reason why Bitcoin is that cheat code is, number one, it helps us beat inflation, right? So it gets us out, it gives us an asset that's outside of the game. Right, so now I can get away from inflation. Because the asset right now is going up by about 55% a year, I can let that asset accrue value and I don't have to pay taxes on that. So now I beat inflation, I beat taxes. On the education side, what happens with Bitcoin is once you have now sort of removed yourself from that system, you start going, well, wait a minute. Like, it's what we call cognitive dissonance. Like, well, now that that's not true, what else isn't true? So then you start to question, like, well, what's going on with my health? And what's going on with the world and my relationships? So then you start to question things, and so then you start to add in your own education.
Yeah.
Right? And so I think that's why Bitcoin has that cheat code, right? It gets me out of the rigged game. But more importantly, it's not just protecting myself from the inflation of debt. It's opening up my mind to realize I was in that track game, and I don't have to be. I didn't talk about it today, but it's something I talk about quite a bit, which a lot of attributes to Bitcoin, but one of them is it's permissionless. And I think that for me, and I'd like more people to realize that once I start using Bitcoin permissionless, I can be permissionless. And what do I mean by that? So, like, I don't need permission from anybody to do anything. So, for example, one of my friend's sisters, she's like this, she works in big corporations. She's like an HR director, human resources. And she's been trying to get a job. She got laid off from a big corporation. She hasn't been able to get a job in like 6 or 9 months, right? And I'm like, she goes on these interviews, no one will hire her. And I'm like, why do you need permission to take your skills to the marketplace? You know how to do human resources and things like that, right? Why do you need permission from an employer? Why can't you just take those directly to the marketplace? Couldn't you be an HR contractor or consultant? And couldn't you be a consultant for 5 businesses or 10 businesses? You don't need somebody to stand behind you as a gatekeeper to allow you to do that. And so all of a sudden you start to look at things differently and like, I can learn skills on my own through YouTube and podcasts. I can then take those skills to the market to earn money. Then I can take my money and put it into Bitcoin, so now I'm not controlled by the banks or any government for that matter. I can travel the world and be anywhere I want. I can take care of my own health. I don't need permission from anybody.
Yeah.
And I can become uncancelable. I can become sovereign.
Yeah. So talking about uncancelable, Nostr, Sven talks about a lot. What are your thoughts on Nostr? Is it a tool that people should start to learn to be able to use, get engaged with? How do you see that playing out?
Yeah. I really like what Nostr is doing, what it is potentially going to do. Unfortunately, I think that we're probably going to really need it. And when I say unfortunately, obviously, the reason why we need something like that is because of the censorship that we're starting to see in the world. I believe right now that's probably the number one problem that we're facing in the world today is censorship. In America right now, we're about to go into an election, and that's like a big one on the ballot right now. So I think that the trend is governments print more money and governments have more censorship. And so we need a tool like Bitcoin, we need a tool like Nostr. So I like it. I think sort of like Bitcoin, the governments could take away any need for Bitcoin if they just went back to a budget and didn't print more money. And they could also take away from the need for Nostr if they didn't censor us, but they're not going to. So I think it's super important. In my fund, we've invested in some projects that are building on Nostr, so we're putting our money actively into that space and trying to help develop that. I think outside of just censorship, being a content creator on YouTube, etc., besides the censorship aspect, I think even being a content creator, being able to kind of control my data, I think is important. And I think there's also a way, really when we think about Bitcoin and we think about Nostr, it's not how can we do what we're already doing, but in a different way. It's how can we do things that we're not able to do? That's a much better question. And so, like, everyone tries to compare Bitcoin against Visa or against the dollar, but it's not about is it a better dollar. It's, well, what can Bitcoin do that other ones can't? For example, how can I set 35 cents somewhere in the world? No way to do that in a fiat system, right? And so what could I do with Nostr that I can't do with traditional social media? And there's a lot of things that we can do. So, like, for example, you mentioned Svensky earlier. So Svensky's working on a company called Satlantis, and it's using, like, a social grid to like bring relevant information to you. I don't want to go super deep unless you want to, but we can't do that with traditional social media today. And so I think that's really where the benefit is. So I'm super excited about it.
No, really, really exciting. And I guess with all the conversations, what's top of mind? Like, say someone maybe late teenage years, 18, 19, 20, they're starting out in the career, they don't have much money, they hear about this Bitcoin thing, number go up technology, they listen to you, they feel like it's absolutely great, it's the answer to all their problems in life, and then someone like yourself, me, says, it'd be good for you to get to at least one Bitcoin, and they're like 67,000, 68,000, that's a little bit hard to achieve. how should they approach life, I guess, as a young person with all the opportunities there are? It's like AI, we are moving into this information age, creativity, YouTube. There's many ways to be able to provide value to the world, but what sort of advice, I guess, would you pass on maybe to the younger generation starting out in their career?
Yeah, so I have a lot of advice for that generation. My daughter is about that age, so I talked to all her friends about this specifically. The first thing I would say is that we get paid for the value we provide. The only reason why anybody would ever give you any money at all is if you provided value to them. And this is where, you know, something say, people say that, well, all the Bitcoin's going to get snapped up and there's not going to be any Bitcoin to go around. There will only be Bitcoin to go around if you provide value for it.
Correct.
Yeah. And so I would just say, think about that. So no one will ever give you money unless you provide value. That's number one. And if, when you think about it in those terms, then you go, so then if I want more money, I have to provide more value. How do I do that? I have to solve bigger problems. How do I do that? Well, I have to learn new skills. You see, most people want to get a job working minimum wage, punching a button at McDonald's, and they want to get paid more and more money every year for doing the same job, but you're not providing any more value. So I would say learn high-value skills so you can make more money. And you have to create value first to get the money. Bitcoin is for savings, but you got to make the money before you can save the money. So for that person that's trying to get to the first Bitcoin, they need to figure out how to make more money, right? What I would say about that is I think what we're seeing today sort of in this information age is a lot of people now have gone in that direction, and there's this big hole of people doing like physical trades, at least in the United States. So plumbers, welders, carpenters, things like that. But I would say that, like, if I wanted to build a house, I would hire trades like that, a plumber, a weaver, a framer. But if I want to build a business, I also hire trades. A graphic designer, a copywriter, a video editor, a paid advertiser, right? And so I think those are also trades. They're specialty skills. So usually what I recommend to my daughter's friends is to learn those types of trades. They're high-value skills around sales and marketing, digital skills. The reason why I like the digital skills over the physical skills is because digital skills allow me to be free of tyranny, place, and time, right? So then I can do that work, that job from anywhere in the world, anytime that I want. And that's massive. I believe something I push is the term called the new rich. The new rich are those who value time and location freedom over just money. And so by learning those digital skills, those digital trades, if you will, they're high demand, they're growing. I make a lot more money with them and I can be free of tyranny from that. So I say start there, learn how to make more money by providing more value. And then, now that you're making more income, turn that into Bitcoin.
Yeah. And what if that approach to Bitcoin does increase fairly rapidly? Are they going to get to a stage like the fear of missing out where the Bitcoin price just runs away from them and they're never going to be able to get where they are? So one option is they could go out and they could get a loan off their parents' gallons of debt to be able to buy the Bitcoin and then figure out how to patchwork these skills together to be able to earn income, to be able to pay off that debt. Is that like a good decision or a bad decision? Like, kids these days are really addicted to debt. Society is addicted to debt, but it can be a tool. But I guess in that situation, is that a good idea or a bad idea and depending on the person?
Well, the problem with debt is that it's, I think of it like fire, where I could use fire to warm up my house, but it could also burn my house down if I don't use it properly. So it's a double-edged sword. And I think, usually kids shouldn't play with fire, but as you grow up to be an adult, you learn how to manage fire. But you also need to learn how to grow up and manage debt. I would say if you're a young kid and you don't have the income to pay for the debt, it's just too much risk.
Yeah.
It's like starting a fire on my carpet, not in the fireplace.
Right? Sound like me as a kid.
Yeah, so I think, you know, if you have a job and you have income and you're able to take on some debt and you can cover that debt no problem, then you've mitigated your risk. But if you don't have a job, then I would just say it's just too much risk. To the person that you're sort of framing up in this, I would say, you know, they're dealing with FOMO, right? Fear of missing out. That's one of the worst conditions, emotional conditions we can have as humans. And humans are horrible investors because we have all these emotions like FOMO. And so what I would say to that person is, look, learn how to go make money. The greatest investment you can make is in yourself, not Bitcoin. The greatest investment you can make is in yourself first, and then probably the greatest investment you can make after yourself is in your own business. You'll make way more in your own business than you will in Bitcoin. Again, Bitcoin is for savings. I look at Bitcoin and I call it not investing. I think of saving in Bitcoin. But again, you can only save what you've created, right?
Danny's trying to avoid it. I'm coming for you. I guess my for the people, for whatever reason, they've not come across you, where can they find you? And as well as that, one book recommendation. I'm a strong believer, read the books or eat the bugs. What's one book, and it doesn't need to necessarily be Bitcoin related, but created such a profound impact or given you a new mental model or changed your external reality from the information you've consumed?
Okay, so first of all, just Google Mark Moss. I'm not hard to find. On YouTube, I do a couple videos a week, so I have two channels on YouTube, Mark Moss and Market Disruptors, and Twitter, Instagram, etc. My website, onemarkmoss.com, everything's linked on there. As far as a book recommendation, I was telling you earlier, like I think of just-in-time learning, so I'm reading all types of books across different disciplines. So I think it's important because you draw all these different areas and you start to connect dots. But as far as like one that's like really open in my mind, I'd probably have to kind of go all the way back to the beginning. And really, I think probably the two most influential books on me in the beginning of my sort of entrepreneurial career were Think and Grow Rich by Napoleon Hill and Rich Dad Poor Dad from Robert Kiyosaki.
Yeah.
And those two books just expanded my mind as to what was possible.
Yeah.
Robert Kiyosaki talks about, I don't have anything to show here, but like two cups. And so like a cup, and I can fill up the content. So that's more knowledge or information. I can fill up my cup with information. But what we need is a bigger cup. We need more context. And so that's what those books do. They open up your mind and they give you you mentioned mental models. That's what Think and Grow Rich does. So I would probably start there. Some other good books, I would say, you know, from sort of an economic, Bitcoin sort of centric view, I think The Road to Serfdom is like a book that everybody should read. It talks of everything from society, the legal system, the monetary system. So I think Road to Serfdom, I would say from two easy books to read, they're like booklets would be The Law, Frederick Bastiat, it's about an hour read. And I would say Anatomy of the State, Rothbard. And while I'm at it, The Accomplished Manifesto,
that's a book I wrote.
From a business standpoint, one of my favorite books is probably Ready, Fire, Aim.
Yep.
And Road to 100 Million. I think it's a great business book. I think everybody should learn how to have people skills. I think another book from Napoleon Hill, which is How to Win Friends and Influence People, another book that people should read. I know you asked me for one.
I absolutely love reading Keith Young.
Yeah, so I'm just kind of rattling off some that I think are super important to read. But I think those probably give everybody a pretty good base to like go from there.
I really appreciate it. Thanks very much, Mark.
Yeah.
Legend.
Yeah.